Hey guys, welcome back. Today I have for you a super simple point-to-point piston-bolt network, and contained in this vault is every intersection, transition, and flying machine that you may need to create your own system. As it's meant to be cheap, it can be built on the nether roof without any bedrock breaking, unless you require stack compatibility. What I mean by point-to-point is that any station can be routed to multiple endpoints, unlike most currently available hub-based systems. This, on the other hand, it's a simple system which is able to directly route between 16 different destinations. So let's take a look. First, I select a station, get on, and launch. As you can see, I'm automatically routed throughout the entire network. And just to show that any station can be a start point, let's go to station 6. And again, I will be automatically routed to my destination. First, I'd like to talk about the bolts themselves and the discoveries that made this entire network possible. Initially, you had your traditional piston bolt design with pistons every block alternating left and right. Then comes along Fake Story, who finds a way to reduce the number of pistons used by alternating them up and down. And after his release of this design, both Fake Story and Inspector Talon start working on what would become the modern Demibolt. Fake Story finds that if you use a sticky piston and a full block in this position, you can push the cart 2 blocks forward. Inspector Talon finds something similar, though instead uses a normal piston in a slightly different position and pushes the cart 2 blocks forward. Now, with the extra space in between the pistons, you can do more interesting operations like what Hexatron finds, which you can have intersecting bolts. In this case, what you can do is you can have a cart that travels straight through, or a cart that diverts off its path to a side path. Corner transitions become very simple, and you can pause the video if you want to rebuild this. And I've also used additional repeaters over here to simplify the build so that the bolt can either turn left or right without changing much, only replacing the repeaters and comparators. For diagonal bolts, it has remained relatively similar, with 4 pistons being pushed at a time. And over here, I have my entry into a diagonal bolt, using extra repeaters here again to simplify the build. And over here, I have the exit out from a diagonal bolt. Stack compatible diagonals are relatively new. As such, there may be bugs that I've missed, though nothing that I currently know of. If you encounter any problems, please leave a comment or contact me through Discord. A lot of the stack compatible diagonal research was done by Hexatron, and I would not have been able to make any of my designs without his help. The main difference between a normal diagonal and a stack-compatible diagonal is the usage of thinner blocks, and that adjacent pistons need to be fired one game tick apart. In order to produce this one game tick offset, I use a scaffolding which powers this gray circuit. However, even with all of this, the cards are only meta-stable and require a specialized recapture device. There are instances where the cards can separate into two groups at the end, so the first step is to regroup them, and then remerge them. I found that a powered rail is necessary to do this quickly, before finally pushing them onto a normal bolt. Overall, only 4 bedrock needs to be broken on each exit. Descending bolts are really easy. All you have to do is push the cart over a lower rail. However, ascending bolts are more difficult and unfortunately, I have not found a simple way of making it stack compatible while still carrying a hex signal. So first, push the card on to a slanted rail, then align it such that the card can travel onto the next rail while not derailing off the slanted rail. Then I use the changed hitbox of the glass pane to push the card forward. And finally, I can launch it further down the line. When looking through this four-way intersection, where cards can enter and exit out from four sides, you'll notice that the card never leaves its Y level. As it enters the crossroad, it can decide to either exit out or continue within the intersection, forward, merge with incoming traffic, deciding again to exit out or continue within the intersection. To decide which exit to take, a hex signal is taken from the bolt, it's brought up into the logic unit, and if the incoming signal is larger than the lectin value, it'll be propagated through subtracting by the lectin value onwards and blocks this output. However, if the incoming signal is lower than the lectin value, this dust turns off, allowing this signal to travel through, having the card exit from this direction. This logic is the basis for all other intersections. Over here, I have a T intersection, which is just a four-way intersection with one side cut off. Over here, I have an expanded intersection, which is just two four-way intersections connected to each other. Over here, I have a diagonal intersection, and this is its stack-compatible counterpart. Here, we have the launch station. It's a very simple design, where you can select your destination through this lectin. And by hitting this node block, you unlock this comparator and replace the card. When the card arrives, it lands on this slanted rail, travels up, gets broken by the cactus, and enters the chest. For diagonal stations, it's really similar, except bent in the center. There are two add-ons that you can attach, the first being a button panel, where node blocks update observers, pouring repeaters, pouring a redstone line that snakes down into a memory cell, which then powers a dus where the lectin would have been, and a player detector, where empty cards divert off the track, and players get ejected out from here. Now, in order to simplify construction of a straight piston bolt, what you can do is build a line of normal rails and powered rails, and then build this flying machine to separate it out into two separate lines of alternating type. Next, you can build this flying machine to curve the rails in the proper direction. This world download also includes some structure blocks so that you can reload the flying machines if you want to take a closer look. Over here, I have the diagonal flying machine, which again curves the rails. And over here, again, the structure blocks to reset it in case you want to take another look. All the flying machines have been slightly modified by me, but I'm not a slime stoner, so maybe someone else can optimize it a little bit better. First up is the separator by Etta. Start by laying out two lines of rails, one of powered rails and one of normal rails, where the normal rails will be the center between the two piston bolts. Then, build the arms like these, followed by the center arm, where you have normal pistons pushing to the sides, and add in a crossbar. Then add in the lower part of the engine, and finally the rest of the engine. Just a take note, the way it separates, you'll get your center rails out like this. Next, you have the rail cover by Pingu. Once you have your alternating rail line, you can just build the arms, and this time the flying machine is symmetrical. Then put in the crossbar and first half of the engine, and then the second half of the engine, and finally a single powered rail that curves the normal rail in the correct direction. For the last flying machine, we have a diagonal rail cover by Ilmango and Samurai. If you are building the diagonal bolt on elevated ground, you may want to use the original, where the curving rails are supported by a block that's part of a flying machine. However, if you're building it on a ground where the slime block can stick to the ground, you might want to use this, which is my modified design. The flying machine is pretty simple. So what you have to do is just build these slime towers with observers powering the blocks. Same thing on the other side. And then sticky pistons that are powering inwards and forwards. And its counterpart. Again, for the other side too. And then sticky pistons that are pushing the opposite slime ball. So you'll see that this piston pushes that. And now this piston pushes this. Finally, add in the remaining observers. So this observer powers this piston. And this observer powers this piston. And finally, you need one observer here to start the flying machine. Once you've created your bolt lines, you need to start worrying about the intersections themselves. And unfortunately, you have to curve the rails manually. So just lay the rails out in this configuration and follow what I do. So start by curving the outer rails and then curving the ring. Before placing the final rail, you'll notice that if I put a rail here, it's going to update that rail, and I want to prevent that. So what I'm going to do is place one rail there, one more rail here, remove that, and now I have the curving rails in the correct position, and all I have to do is remove this normal rail and place it back again, and now I have my inner ring of rails curved. Next, I need to curve one more position in the outer ring. So again, I can't put a rail here because it's going to update that. So I have to put one rail there, remove that, place that there, and there we go. Now I have my outer rail curved in the proper direction. So just get all that. Then I'm going to remove the extra rails over here. And then I'm going to fill in the power rails in the center. Obviously, I can't put the part rails there again because it's going to update the adjacent rails. So I have to place outer and inner. And now I have my rails curved in the proper direction. If you ever make a mistake and let's say actually curve a rail like this, now that it's broken, what you have to do is just remove all of it, place the rails like this, curve it, and then put in the power rails again. Alright, I'm not going to do a block by block tutorial, but I'm going to do it in sections instead. So now that you have your rail lines curved, you're going to just need to add in two more power rails over here on each side. You're going to add in all your pistons and the blocks that are going to power the pistons. Pause the video if you need to see what you're missing. Next is the data lines. So it just takes a hex signal from the bolt, it puts it into a ring, and then outputs it out to a bolt exit. Again, pause if you need to see what you're missing. Next, you have your logic unit. So you're going to add in a lectern and comparator over here. And just this orange circuit. And lastly, you're going to add in some additional torches over here to power some of the pistons for the piston bolt line. Again, same thing over here. And then lastly, you're going to have to encode the lecterns over here. Now, it may be a bit difficult to explain how the encoding works, but I'll try my best. So take, for example, starting here and ending there. What I'm going to do is I'm going to count the number of stations I would pass if I'm following just the outer right edge. So start here, that's C, going down these branches, count 1, count 2, 3, 4, 5, and finally I reach 6. So if I want to reach this station, from this position, I need to input a signal strength of 6. Obviously, the cut doesn't actually travel down the branch, so what it does is that it travels to the intersection and it knows that there are two stations over there. So it takes 6 minus 2 is 4, continues onwards into the next intersection, and now we have an input signal of 4 and we are comparing it to 4. And now that we know it's equal or less, we take this path down, enters this intersection, 4 minus 3 is 1, and 1 is equal or less than 1, so it exits out and arrives at its station. So basically what you have to do is at every sign, or which is what you're going to encode the lectin with, you're going to encode the number of stations within that branch. So I have 2 over here, I have 2 over here, and I have 1 over here. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 among these 3 branches, and I know that there's a total of 16 stations. So 16 minus 5 equals 11. Do this for all your intersections and you'll be able to encode for a 16 station network. Because the signal strength input at each start point routes to a different destination, that means that if I want to go to, let's say, station 10, and I start either from 0 or 6, I would have to input different signal strength values. Obviously, I could alter the signal strength input in order to always go to 10, but the easier method is to actually just change what you write in the lectin. So over here, I start from 1 and I end at 15. Over here, I start at 2 and I go all the way to 15 and then go back to 0. And every time I increment 3, it goes to 15 and then goes to 0 and 1. It is actually possible to have more than 16 stations. However, you have to manipulate the encoding a little bit. This network design is similar to something by Blowing Minds, however it adds in the feature of having multiple branches to the side. If you were to start from this green station, you can only access all these lime stations. And the reason for this is that the encoding has been manipulated, where the birch signs actually tell you the truth, where there's only one station here. Well, this jungle sign says that there are only 9 stations here, but you can obviously see that there are more. And by manipulating the encoding a little bit differently, you can actually prevent this station from accessing more than 9 stations within this direction. So if I have 9 or lower, it's going to take this path. But if I go 10 and above, it's going to either go to this station or any of these other stations down here. Alright guys, that's all for today. If you do intend to build this network, I would highly recommend that you download this world as it contains everything you're going to need. Also, check out all the links I leave below, as many people have either contributed directly or indirectly to the creation of this network. And on top of that, I'm actually designing an even more complex network that allows for directly transferring between over 1,000 different destinations. And you guys, if you've enjoyed this video, please leave a like, comment, and subscribe. Hit that bell icon to be notified. And last but not least, stay zen. Bye!